Hello, I'm Dr. Sabag here on behalf of the VMR Research Foundation. Many of you have connected with us via the VDM project set up by Fabio Gallerani and all of his associates, a very useful outreach program to the global community at large in search of patients suffering from vitreous floaters, to provide education and support and to promote research towards a better understanding of this disease and improvement of therapies and cures. Thank you for all of the support that many of you have provided over recent years. We appreciate that and look forward to continued support. And my purpose today is to answer some questions that some of you have submitted as part of your interaction with the VDM Project website. So the first of these questions is, what research projects is the VMR Research Foundation working on right now, and which ones require urgent funding? The most recent update is actually very current. We've done a lot of work over recent years and published these, and all of that information is available to you. You just have to reach out to us, and we'd be happy to provide all of the details. But for an overview of what's actually happening right now, I can share that 2 days ago, I presented a lecture at the International Retinal Imaging Symposium, which was held at UCLA in Los Angeles, California. The topic of my presentation was myopic vitreopathy and vision-degrading myodysopsia. Myopic vitreopathy refers to the changes that occur in the center of the eye, where the structure called vitreous is located. And the reason that's relevant is because clinically significant cases of vitreous floaters, which are called vision degrading myodysopsia or VDM, result in many patients from myopia. In fact, myopic vitreopathy, the abnormalities of vitreous associated with nearsightedness, is the second leading cause of clinically significant vitreous floaters, which we call VDM. So we performed a study on patients with myopia, and we correlated the degree of nearsightedness with the degree of unhappiness, with the degradation in contrast sensitivity, which is their ability to discern shades of gray, and with the density of the vitreous body, and found multiple correlations that help us understand the relationship between the vitreous body, nearsightedness, and the development of floaters. And it was very well received. In fact, following the presentation, I had conversations with optical engineers who have plans to develop a new three-dimensional OCT system. These are people who I've known for a while now, but in spite of previous discussions, it didn't seem to trigger the kind of interest that I sensed in my discussions with them. So we're going to be discussing ways that we can collaborate to help build a new imaging system of what's going on inside the eye that will enable us to measure these changes and better understand the origins of floaters so that we can better design new treatments for patient care. And so that, I would say, is one of the projects that's going to require urgent funding. I really don't know at this point how much, but any support that you can offer would be much appreciated. The second item in response to this question is to share with you that in 3 weeks, the largest eye research meeting in the world will be held. The organization is called ARVO, which is an acronym for the Association for Research in Vision and Ophthalmology. And this meeting is global. This year it will be held in New Orleans, Louisiana. And it's a one-week meeting that features 10 or 12,000 people from all over the world coming together to share research on many different aspects of the eye and of vision. And my collaborators and I have four presentations at this meeting. One involves the VFFQ, which is the Vitreous Floaters Functional Questionnaire. It's a questionnaire that we've developed to specifically query and quantify the degree of impact that floaters have on patients' quality of life. And it's more insightful and powerful than any existing questionnaires. And we have over 300 respondents to this questionnaire. We analyze it in various different ways, and the details will be forthcoming in future publications. So I don't want to belabor this interaction with all of those details, but that's one of the presentations. Another presentation is the results of work that we're doing to study light scattering in vitreous of patients who have vitreous floaters that are debilitating and that cause them much suffering. In several of these cases, I've excised the vitreous from the eye during surgery to cure the floaters, but rather than throw it away, I arranged with a laboratory at the University of Murcia in Spain to analyze this with very advanced optical methods. And we're correlating the results of those analyses with other aspects of these patients to get a better understanding of how does light interact with the vitreous to create floaters and to disturb vision and degrade quality of life. We also have a presentation on ultrasonography with a new ultrasound system. In the past, we've had much success using ultrasound to image what's going on inside the eye in patients with floaters using a probe that has a single element. But the industry has developed a probe that has five elements integrated into one probe, and that should be significantly more powerful, more revealing, and more helpful in evaluating patients who complain of floaters to find out what's going on inside the center of their eye in the structure called vitreous that would enable us to understand and evaluate and treat patients with floaters. Lastly, I'm going to be giving a lecture on vision-degrading myodysopsia and on surgery for VDM at this International Eye Research Conference. So I think we're going to be successful in promoting the cause of patients with floaters at this meeting. Giving a lecture at a podium exposes the topic to 1,000 or 2,000 people. The other presentations have less outreach, but still it's very important to communicate to eye researchers and eye doctors how we need to emphasize more importance on the question of vitreous floaters. So the ultrasound system research is funded by the NIH. We have a grant from the National Eye Institute. And so I would say that's not in need of urgent funding, but the development of the questionnaire, the support of the laboratory at the University of Murcia in Spain is in need of funding. And we also are working with a gentleman at Columbia University and a medical student at the University of Indiana who are developing a research project to identify and clarify the epidemiology, just how many people are out there with floaters and how severe are these floaters. It's a very important project that needs funding. And so if you could support the VDM project, we would be in a better position to provide funding and conduct this research. Lastly, we also need funding for statistical validation of the VFFQ questionnaire, which I described earlier. So I would say in answer to that question, there are several projects that are in need of funding, and we would appreciate your support in that regard. The second question asks whether we can have floaters severity classification. And we have floaters recognized as a disease if we classify different severity levels? That's a good question. And I think that theoretically that is true, but in my experience, that's putting the cart before the horse, meaning that I doubt that a classification system is going to stimulate disease acceptance. Rather, in my experience, disease acceptance comes first, leading to a need for a classification system. But I'm prepared to be proven wrong, and rather than just make decisions based on my opinion, I'm going to consult with the members of our scientific advisory board to the VDM project and see what their thoughts are. And I'll be happy at a future point in time to share the results of those discussions with all of you. The third question is concerning laser treatments. Is there anything else on YAG laser or femtosecond laser treatments? YAG laser vitreolysis is performed frequently, but it's a difficult subject. And the reason is that there have never been any valid scientific studies proven that YAG laser vitreolysis works. Consequently, there's no support from governments or insurance companies in terms of financing YAG laser treatments, and patients have to do so out of pocket. So that's one indication that there's a lot of information that's lacking from the implementation of YAG lasers to treat vitreous floaters. In fact, just a few months ago, the National Institute for Centers of Excellence in the United Kingdom, it's called NICE, that's the acronym, and they oversee the validity of various ways to practice medicine in different parts of the body. They did an analysis and concluded that because there is no evidence that YAG lasers work, the performance of YAG laser vitreolysis should only be done by retinal specialists and not general ophthalmologists, and should only be done in the context of a research project. And so in response to that, I have initiated a collaboration with a colleague in London, Professor Paolo Stanga, who's a member of our scientific advisory board to the VDM project. And he and I are going to collaborate on a prospective scientific study to evaluate whether or not YAG laser treatment works. There's evidence to suggest that it doesn't, but within that evidence, there seems to be a subgroup of people who are happy with the results. And we don't know whether that's a placebo effect or whether there are actually changes in the vitreous structure and improvements in the contrast sensitivity that explain why this small subgroup of people are happy. So we're hoping to perform this prospective study and test people before, during, and after YAG laser treatments in order to get the answers to those questions and determine, does it work or not? And if it works, who are the people that are most likely to respond? Because you don't want to treat everybody in the hopes of helping that subgroup of people. We would like to identify who they are and make recommendations as to not just whether or not they should be treated, but how they should be treated. So that's an exciting new project that we're working on that hopefully will be able to share results in the coming months and years. The fourth question relates to the Nanobubble project, and that refers to research that is being performed at the University of Ghent in Belgium, and I've collaborated with this group for a few years now, and we've published a couple of papers together, sharing with the world the results of our experiments. Initial experiments were done in vitro, which means in dishes in a laboratory, and subsequent to those successful experiments, we performed experiments in rats in collaboration with scientists at the University of Michigan in the United States. What those experiments were intended to show is whether it's safe and whether it's effective, meaning the use of nanoparticles that adhere to the opacities in the vitreous body that cause the visual phenomenon of floaters. We've shown preferential adherence, and we've shown that you can use a low-level laser light to create nanobubbles that break the opacities and improve the situation. But obviously, we're not able to measure vision in rabbits. We're not able to ask them, are you happy? So these are highly suggestive, but not proof that there's a role for nanotechnology in the treatment of patients with vitreous floaters. We need to do extensive clinical testing to prove safety, first and foremost, but also to prove efficacy. And in order to do that correctly, requires the participation of partners, partners in government, partners in industry. And right now, we are in the process of seeking those partners so that the right kind of clinical research can be performed to help people who are suffering from vitreous floaters. So that's a brief update of the things that we're working on. And I'm very, very appreciative of all the support that we've received from all of you that have helped us with the information that I just presented and the events that are occurring and the contribution to the fund of knowledge throughout the world, but also to increase the awareness within the scientific community, within the medical community, and with the world at large, that vitreous floaters are not just a nuisance. In many cases, they're an actual disease. And we call that disease vision-degrading myodysopsia. It's worthy of the same respect and consideration that we offer people with other diseases, whatever it might be. And floaters are that kind of condition. And we're hoping that the scientific evidence that we're producing will raise the level of awareness and raise the support from governments and industry. But the support begins with all of you. And Fabio Gallerani and I are very appreciative of your engagement in the VDM project and your support of the VMR Research Foundation. Thank you very much for your attention and have a good day.